Dear students, today we are going to discuss about plants, microbes and human welfare. The chapter name, strategies for enhancement in food production. Generally, Dr. M.S. Swaminathan is considered as a father of green revolution in India, as well as Norman Borlaug is considered as father of the green revolution in the worldwide. So first we are going to discuss about what is the meaning of green revolution. Several countries including India is experiencing the substantial and dramatic increasing of agricultural production or food production. Agricultural production or food production, that is called green revolution. That is called green revolution. Dr. M.S. Swaminathan has to be developed short duration, increasing of high yield variety of rice, includes those of basmati variety of rice. So these plants are having to high yielding and high resistance diseases, and to be produced high quality food materials. Then after Dr. M.S. Swaminathan and Norman Borlaug accumulated to the one process within the green revolution, so to be introduced to so many Mexican varieties of wheat in India. So however, the green revolution is always depend upon to the very longer extents of plant breeding. Generally, plant breeding as a technology has helped to increase yielding and disease resistance to very longer extents. That is the plant breeding. Okay, now, so plant breeding program, so is always to be depend upon to the green revolution, or green revolution is always depend upon to the plant breeding technology. Okay, now, so plant breeding program is carried out in the same way to be worldwide. So in our educational institutions or other commercial companies, so in a recent times, beginning of the human civilization, the plant breeding has recorded. So during of the time 9000 to 11000 years, by means the plant breeding is also well developed thousands of years ago. But this process is very, very slow process, and being of the longer period of the time, Okay, now, anyhow, so plant breeding is always carried out only one specific new genes in a given crop. So that is the importance of plant breeding. So plant breeding is always carried out involves two desirable genetically different plants or parents are involved. Then after to be produced one variety of hybrid plant. This variety of hybrid plant containing both parental characters. That is the importance of plant breeding. Okay, now plant breeding mainly involves two different desirable genetically parental plants. So these two different parental plants are combined, then will be produced one breeding plant or one hybrid variety plant. This hybrid variety plant containing both different parental characters. Okay, now, this is a plant breeding. So in this plant breeding involves five steps. First step are here collection of variability. Second step are here evolution and selection of parents. Third step are here cross hybridization among the selected parents. Fourth step are here selection and testing of superior recombinants. Fifth step are here testing, release and commercialization of new cultivars. So these are the five steps are involved in plant breeding process. First we are going to discuss about first step collection of variability. Okay, now collection of variability. So here first to be taken genetic variability is an important the plant breeding technique process. So here genetic variability is important one of the plant breeding technique. Any plant breeding technique. So first of all to be taken up genetic variability to be identified. So here genetic variability is important of any one of the plant breeding technology. So second here collection and preservation of different wild types and relatives of the species for the pre-existence of exploration of new generation of genes in the population. That is collection and preservation of wild species. Okay, now first step now collection of variability. So collection of variability, first collection are here genetic variability is important of any plant breeding technology. Next one here collection and preservation of different wild type plants or different wild species are related in the cultivation of free existence in the exploration of new generation of the genes in their population. Next one here germplasm collection. So the collection of any plants or seeds having so different diverse of colors of genes in a given crop, that is called germplasm collection. Okay, now so to be collected here any plant or any seeds having so different alleles of genes, in a given crop, that is called germplasm collection. So that is the first step now here, collection of variability. Okay, now collection of variability including first genetic variability, second collection and preservation of different wild plants, different wild species or different related species. Third, germplasm collection. The collection of any plant or any seed are having to different types of alleles or alleles of genes in a given crop, that is called germplasm collection. So these three are involved in the first step of collection of variability. So second step are here evolution and selection of parents. So already evolved germplasm, thereafter to be selected two desirable genetic characters of different plants or different parents. Okay, now already evolved germplasm, thereafter to be taken off two different desirable genetic characters of plants. So thereafter these two different genetically desirable characters of plants undergo by self-pollination. Undergo self pollination. So wherever desirable and possible, wherever desirable and possible, that is the importance of second step, that is evolution and selection of parents. So already evolved germplasm, then after to be selection of parents. So in those of time to be taken up two different desirable genetical characters of plants, that is two parental plants, that is two parental plants, both parental plants are here different, and also different desirable genetical characters are having to both plants, and in those of both plants are having to self pollination, and also desirable characters as well as possible or not possible. That is the second step for here, evolution and selection of parents. So these two steps are involved plant breeding technology or plant breeding process. Okay, now so however this plant breeding plants is always greater higher yielding and resistance to diseases and increasing of tolerant to atmospheric stresses and increasing tolerant to resistant to pathogens and increasing abiotic to insect pests, increasing abiotic to insect pests. So totally are useful in economically to be plant breeding plants, to be plant breeding plants. Dear students, today we are going to discuss about third step in plant breeding. So that is cross hybridization among selected parents. Already to be selected in those of two different desirable genetical characters of plants. So one parent plant are having to high quality of protein character. Another parent plant are having to high resistance disease characters. So these are the two different so desirable genetical characters of parental plants. One parental plant are having to high quality of protein characters. Another parent plant are having to high resistance disease characters. Okay, now so in those of two different genetical desirable characters of plants for crossing 100 to thousands of times, 100 to thousands of times, finally we would be resulted only one desirable hybrid plant, only one desirable hybrid plants. Okay, now third step are here, already selected two different desirable genetical characters of plants, both are two different parental plants. One parent plant are having high quality of protein characters. Another parent plant are having to high resistance disease characters. So these four parental plants are among to the cross hybridization. So how many times are cross hybridization? But different plant varieties. That is cross hybridization among the 100 to thousands of times. 100 to thousands of times. Finally, would be resulted only one of the desirable hybrid character plant. Only one desirable hybrid character of plant. So here, plant breeding is a very longer extensive process. Plant breeding is a very longer extensive process. This is a very very older method. So being of the time is very high. Okay, now fourth step are here, selection and testing of superior recombinants. Already would be resulted to be developed to some of the desirable hybrid character plants. So these desirable hybrid plant characters are having to both of their parental characters, that are having to high quantity of protein characters and high resistance species characters. That is called superior recombinants. That is called superior recombinants. Okay, now third step are here. Finally, will be resulted some of the desirable hybrid character of plants. So these hybrid desirable hybrid of characters of plants to be selected in testing of superior recombinants. So these hybrid character of plants are not containing high quantity of protein characters, high resistance of disease characters. So both characters are having to desirable hybrid characters of plants. That is superior recombinants of plants. That is superior recombinants of plants. Okay, now. So finally, it will be resulted only one desirable hybrid character of plants. This desirable hybrid characters of plants are having to both parental characters. That is named superior recombinations. That is named superior recombinations. So in those of superior recombination plants will be self pollinated for several generations. For several generations till they reach of a unity of homozygosity. Unity of homozygosity. By means both of the characters are containing similar kinds of the genes. Similar kinds of the genes such as high quantity of protein genes and high resistance disease genes. High resistance disease genes. So these genes of these characters will not segregated in their progeny. Will not segregated in their progeny. That is the importance of selection and testing of superior recombinants. Superior recombinants. Superior recombinants means the selected hybrid variety of plant containing both parental characters. As high quantity of protein characters as well as high resistance disease characters. Fifth step are here, testing, release and commercialization of new cultivars. Anyhow, to be selected so many hybrid plants. So these hybrid plants are grown in richest fields. Are grown in richest fields, and their performance is always to be noted. One recorded, and to be observation in their agricultural fields of irrigation and not utilized irrigation process. So up to date to be noted. So the movement of selected plants. Next one here, in those of testing of hybrid lines is done in farmer field after evolution. After some time, these selected or testing of hybrid plants is done in farmer field after evolution. And finally, after testing crop is grown in at different locations in our country. At different agroclimatic zones, but these plants grown in any three seasons. So these selected hybrid plants are grown in any three seasons, and thereafter finally will be released is bulk done by selected and certified. This is the plant breeding process. In their plant breeding process are involved 5 steps. So in those of first step are here collection of variability. First one here, genetically variability is an important any plant breeding process. Okay, now collection of variability. So first will be collected genetically variability. Then after to be collected germplasm. Okay, now that is collection of variability. Okay, here next one here, selection of parental plants. So next one to be selected two different desirable genetical characters of plants to be selected. So these plants are always will be self-pollinated. So these self-pollinated plants are flowering wherever possible or not possible, desirable and possible. Next one here, two selected plants among the cross hybridization. So those plants will be produced one variety of hybrid plants. This hybrid plant are containing both parental characters, that is superior recombinants. That is superior recombinants. These superior recombinants so undergo several times self pollinated and finally reach of the homozygosities and not segregated of the characters in the progeny. And finally, so to be testing of selected plants in research field and their performance is always noted to be recorded, then after to be testing of farmer field, after finally to be testing of different locations of in our country, especially in different agroclimatic zones. So in those plants only will be grown any three seasons. That is the importance of plant breeding. So the green revolution is always depend upon to the plant breeding. Plant breeding is very longer extensive process. Plant breeding is a very longer extensive process. So the green revolution is always depend upon to the very longer extensive of plant breeding process. All plant breeding plants are having to high quality of protein materials and high resistance diseases and increasing of tolerance to atmospheric stresses and increasing of resistance to pathogens and increasing tolerance to insect pests. Increasing tolerance to insect pests. That is the importance of plant breeding. So here plant breeding is one of the green revolution. Dear students, today we are going to discuss about Indian hybrid crop plants. India is an agricultural country. Agriculture accounts approximately 33% of India's GDP. That is gross domestic products, and employs nearly 62% of India's in agriculture. Anyhow, after independence, to be increasing of the population and decreasing of the food material. So in those of time to be invasion, one scientist that is named Dr. M.S. Swaminathan. So Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, several countries, especially India's, is experienced substantial and dramatic increasing of agricultural production or food production. That is called the green revolution. So father of green revolution in India, that is M.S. Swaminathan. M.S. Swaminathan is also known as father of green revolution. So here Dr. M.S. Swaminathan around 1960s to be introduced to some of the semi-dwarf variety of crop plants, mainly such as wheat plant, rice plant and also maize plant Especially Dr. M.S. Swaminathan to be introduced in India some of the hybrid crop plants such as wheat, rice and maize. After then, several hybrid crop plants are introduced in India. So in India are having to several hybrid crop plants or several breeding crop plants. So here, okay, now first we are going to discuss about what is the meaning of hybrid crop plants or plant breeding So here plant breeding is the process, so in which purposeful manipulation of plant species, purposeful manipulation of plant species in order to create a desirable plant types. Desirable plant types. These plant types are having to better suitable cultivation, better suitable cultivation, and higher yielding and disease resistant. That is called plant breeding. That is called plant breeding. So in those of these are plant breeding plants. These are breeding plants. In those of these are breeding plants. So first we are going to discuss about one of the Indian breeding crop plants such as wheat. So here, in the year around 1962 and 1969 and also 2000, so the wheat production is increased 11 million tons to 75 million tons. 11 million tons to 75 million tons. Okay, now Dr. M.S. Swaminathan to be introduced some of the hybrid varieties in the Mexican, that is Mexican wheat, Mexican maize, Mexican rice. Okay, now so here in the year around 1969 to 2000, so in the year 1969 the wheat production are here 11 million tons, but still 2000 are here increasing of the 75 million tons. So here the wheat production increased from 11 million tons to 75 million tons. 75 million tons. So Dr. M.S. Swaminathan to be introduced to semi-dwarf variety of wheat plants. Okay, now Dr. M.S. Swaminathan as well as Norman Borlaug to be introduced to semi-dwarf varieties of wheat plants. Such as one is Sonalika, another one is Kalyan Sona. Okay, now one is Sonalika, another one is Kalyana Sona. Kalyan Sona in the year 1963. So these two semi-dwarf variety of wheat plants are having to higher yield and disease resistance and high nutrient quality food materials. That is the importance of wheat. So this Sonalika and Kalyan Sona type of two semi-dwarf variety of wheat plants are to be introduced in India in the year 1963. So second one are here rice. So in the year 1969 the rice production is 35 million tons. Then after in the year 2000, so the rice production will to be increased 889.5 million tons. That is the rice production increase from 35 million tons to 8895 million tons. Okay, now so Dr. M.S. Swaminathan is also introduced again to semi-dwarf variety of rice plants. Dr. M.S. Swaminathan to be crossing with two semi-dwarf variety of cropping plants. One is IR8, another one is TN1. Okay, here plant breeding is the process in which purposefully manipulation of different species in order to create a one desirable plant types. That is plant breeding. So here one is IR8 rice cross with TN1 rice. So IR8 derived from International Rice Research Institute. This International Rice Research Institute, that is IRRI. Located in Philippines. So another rice crop are here TN1. That is T for Thai Chan, N for Native 1. Thai Chan Native 1 is located Taiwan. Is located Taiwan. So to be produced two hybrid crop plants, two hybrid rice crop plants. That is Jaya and Ratna. That is Jaya and Ratna. So the Jaya and Ratna, two semi dwarf variety of rice crop plants to be introduced in India in the year 1966. In the year 1966. However, two semi dwarf variety of wheat plants such as Sonalika and Kalyan Sona, two semi dwarf variety of rice plants such as Jaya and Ratna. So these are breeding crop plants, or these are hybrid plants. So these hybrid plants are having to high tolerant to environmental stresses, high tolerant to resistant diseases, so high quality of food materials and high disease resistance. These are the important character features of breeding crop plants or hybrid crop plants. So these two hybrid crop plants will be resulted the crossing with two different rice species. Two different rice species. One is IR8, another one is TN1. Okay, here, dear students, IR8 cross with TN1. Okay, now IR8 so is available International Rice Research Institute located Philippines. TN1 is available Taichan Native 1 located Taiwan. So these are the two important hybrid variety of crop plants. Okay, now next we are going to third hybrid crop plant, that is sugarcane. So here one sugarcane species are here, Saccharum barberi. Another sugarcane species are here, Saccharum apsinarum. Both are sugarcane species. Okay, here both are rice species would be resulted two hybrid crop plants. So both are two sugarcane species. So one sugarcane species are here, Saccharum barberi. Another sugarcane species are here, Saccharum apsinarum. So Saccharum barberi generally grown in North India. This Saccharum barberi are having to poor sugar content and yield. This is the important character features of Saccharum barberi. Okay, now another species are here, Saccharum apsinarum, grown in South India and are having thick stems and higher yielding. These are the general character features of Saccharum apsinarum. Okay, now dear students, so both two are sugarcane species. One is Saccharum barberi species, another one is Saccharum apsinarum species. Saccharum barberi generally are grown in North India. Saccharum apsinarum are generally grown in South India. This is one character feature. Further character feature are here, Saccharum barberi are having poor sugar content and yield. Saccharum apsinarum are having two thick stems and high yield. So the next one here, crossing with two species would be resulted one variety of sugarcane breeding plant. This sugarcane variety of breeding plant is generally grown in North India and are having to both parental characters. The sugarcane variety of breeding plant are having to both parental characters. That means such as, so higher yielding, thick stems and rich content of sugar. That is the importance of sugarcane breeding plant. Okay, now next fourth one here, millets. Millets are here, maize, jowar and bajra. So maize, jowar and bajra, these are the millets. So these hybrid maize, hybrid jowar, hybrid bajra is always resistant to water stress. These also are have been well developed in India. That is millets. So these are the Indian hybrid breeding crop plants. these are the Indian hybrid breeding crop plants. These Indian hybrid breeding crop plants were first introduced by Dr. M. S. Swaminathan, that is Vanakkambu Sambhasivan Swaminathan. So hence he is considered as a father of green revolution in India. So anyhow, finally, so several hybrid crop variety of plants are introduced in India. That credit goes to Dr. M. S. Swaminathan as well as Norman Borlaug. So here two semi-dwarf variety of wheat plants such as Sonalika and Kalyan Sona, two semi-dwarf variety of rice plants such as Jaya and Ratna, and one semi-dwarf sugarcane crop plant, that is Evergreen of sugarcane variety, and also some of the hybrid millets such as maize, jowar, bajra. These are having to higher quantity of food materials, higher resistance diseases, and also as well as resistance to water stress. Okay, now thank you. Dear students, today we are going to learn about plant breeding resistant to pathogens or diseases. Okay, now dear students, Dr. M. S. Swaminathan had been introduced several breeding crop plants, especially mainly breeding crop plants such as wheat, rice, maize, jowar, bajra, and as well as brassica cauliflower. So here, in those of breeding plants are infected by some of the pathogens. Those pathogens such as fungi, bacteria, virus. The fungal pathogen, the bacterial pathogen, the virus pathogen to be infected by breeding crop plants. Hybrid crop plants. Especially, fungi is infected by some of the breeding crop plants to be cause of diseases. That is brown rust of wheat. So here brown rust of wheat is caused by one fungal organism. Red dot of sugarcane is caused by one fungal organism. Late blight of potato is caused by one fungal organism. Mainly the fungal pathogen or the fungal organism to be cause some useful economically hybrid cropping plants such as wheat, potato, and sugarcane. So that is brown rust of wheat. To be caused by one fungal pathogen. Late blight of potato is caused by one fungal pathogen. Red rot of sugarcane is caused by one fungal pathogen. At the same time, bacteria are infected by hybrid crop plants to be causing of some diseases, especially black rot of cruciferae is caused by one type of bacterial pathogen, and also tobacco mosaic disease, honey mosaic disease is caused by one viral organism. So several pathogens mainly involves fungal organisms, bacterial organisms, and viral organisms to be infected by some of the Indian breeding crop plants. So however, this plant breeding resistant to pathogens or diseases. So the method of breeding resistant to pathogens or diseases. So two methods are here. One is conventional breeding. Second one is mutation breeding. Okay, now dear students. So methods of breeding for resistance to pathogens. To be involved two methods. First method are here conventional breeding. Second one here mutation breeding. conventional breeding. Okay, now is one of the traditional cropping derivatives. By means is always crossing or hybrids to be resulted of few lines and after selection and to be produced hybrid variety plant. These plant are having to high resistance and high yielding and is always tolerant to atmospheric stresses and is always tolerant to air-borne stresses and is always resistant to pathogens or diseases. This is the conventional breeding. So in this conventional breeding method are involved mainly two steps. First step are here hybridization. Second step are here selection. By means, so the plant breeding is the purposeful manipulation of two plant species. So in order to create a desirable two types of plants that having to have better cultivation, get better yield, and also higher disease resistant. That is the importance of plant breeding. As well as conventional breeding. So this conventional breeding to be introduced by Dr. M. S. Swaminathan. To be introduced to several cropping hybrid plants, mainly such as wheat, maize, and rice. Okay, now so these are the conventional breeding crop plants. So these conventional breeding crop plants such as wheat, brassica, cauliflower, cowpea, and chili. So these are the varieties and these are the resistance to disease. So here discuss about one by one. So first one is here Himagiri variety of wheat. Is resistant to in which disease? That is leaf and stipe rust disease. Okay, now so these are the conventional breeding of cropping plants. These conventional breeding of cropping plants as depend upon to the very large extent of plant breeding process. So this plant breeding is always depend upon to the green revolution. So this green revolution first to be introduced by Dr. M. S. Swaminathan. Selected several conventional breeding crop plants. Such as first one here, Himagiri variety of wheat crop is always resistant to leaf and stipe rust disease. Second one, Pusa Swarnim variety of brassica crops is always resistant to white rust disease. Okay, now next one, Pusa Subara and Pusa Snowball K1 variety of cauliflower crop. Is always resistant to black rot disease. Next one is here, Pusa Komal variety of cowpea crops is always resistant to bacterial blight disease. And next one here, Pusa Sadabahar variety of chili crop is always resistant to chili mosaic virus and tobacco mosaic virus disease. Okay, now these are the conventional breeding of variety of crop plants. Is always resistant to some diseases. resistant to some diseases. Second one is here, mutation breeding. Generally, mutation is one of the inheritable and variation. So the organism is always undergoes that the mutation, that is called mutant. That is called mutant. So here, so some of the physical agents and some of the chemical agents caused by mutations, that is called mutagens. That is called mutagens. Some physical agents and some chemical agents to be causing of the mutations. Okay, now to be causing of the mutations. So that is known as mutagens. So some of the physical mutagens are here. Okay, now dear students, X rays, alpha rays, beta rays, gamma rays, and UV rays. UV rays, that is ultraviolet rays. That is ultraviolet rays. And the chemical mutagens are here. Chemical mutagens are here. So caustic and another one, nitrous oxide, caustic and nitrous oxide, caustic and nitrous oxide, and also mustard gas, and also mustard gas. These are the chemical mutagens. Chemical mutagens. Okay, now plant breeding resistant to pathogens or diseases. First method are here, conventional breeding method. Second method are here, mutation breeding method. First we are going to discuss about what is the meaning of mutation. So generally, mutation is one of the process, so in which characters are passed from one generation to another generation. That is short form, inheritable and variation. Inheritable and variation. So every organism undergo that the mutation, that is called mutex. That is called mutex. But here some of the physical agents and some of the chemical agents, okay, now to be caused mutations. These are known as mutagens. These are known as mutagens. Some of the physical mutagens are here: X rays, alpha rays, beta rays, gamma rays, and UV rays. Okay, now and another chemical mutagens are here: caustic, mustard gas, and nitrous oxide. Nitrous oxide. Okay, now so anyhow, so several the mutagens of genes are incorporated into the another species of breeding crop plants. Another species of breeding crop plants. Okay, now so here that is always some of the species of genes is incorporated into the another species by means one species of characters are passed to another species. That is the mutation breeding. Given the for examples are here. So resistance to yellow mosaic virus. Resistant to yellow mosaic virus in mung bean. In mung bean, resistant to yellow mosaic virus in mung bean also is one of the mutation breeding. Okay, now mutation breeding, the best examples are here: resistant to yellow mosaic virus. Resistant to yellow mosaic virus. Okay, now resistant to yellow mosaic virus to be mung bean, also the mutation breeding, Then after resistant to yellow mosaic virus in bindi, then after transferred in another wild species, then after to be produced new variety of species, that is called Parbani Kranti. Okay, now that is called Parbani Kranti. Okay, now mutation breeding, the best examples are here: yellow mosaic disease virus. Some of the viruses are infected by some plants to be causing of yellow mosaic disease. Yellow mosaic disease is due to the mutation is due to the mutation. That means several genes are incorporated into one species to another species. Okay, now at the same time, hairy leaves, so is always supported to be incorporated into the another genes. Incorporated into the other genes of the species. Another genes of the species. These are the examples for mutation breeding. Okay, now. So next we are going to discuss about plant breeding developing for resistance to insect pests. Insect pests. Especially some of the insect pests are infected by several Indian crop breeding plants. Already known Dr. M.S. Swaminathan to be introduced several breeding crop plants. These several breeding crop plants are infected by some of the pathogenic organisms as well as infected by some of the insect pests. Some of the insect pests such as aphids, jassics, aphids and jassics, and also butterflies, and also mosquitoes, and also mosquitoes. These are the infected by plant breeding crop plants. Plant breeding crop plants. Okay, now, so to be discussed about some of the plant breeding crop plants resistant to insect pests. Resistant to insect pests. Okay, now, so first one here, Pusa Gaurav. So here, Pusa Gaurav variety of brassica crop resistant to one type of insect pest, that is aphids. That is aphids. That is aphids. Okay, now once again, Pusa Gaurav variety of brassica crops resistant to one type of insect pest, that is aphids. That is aphids. So next one here, Pusa Centu and Pusa Centri variety of plant bean crops. So is always resistant to insect pest, that is jassics and aphids. That is jassics and aphids. Okay, now next one, Pusa Savani variety of okra, that is bindi. That is bindi. So the scientific name of bindi, Abelmaster's esculentus. Abelmaster's esculentus, that is lady's finger. That is lady's finger. Okay, now Pusa Savani variety of okra crops is always resistant to one insect pest, that is shoot and fruit borer. Shoot and fruit borer. So these are the some breeding crop plants. So these breeding crop plants is always resistant to pathogens and is always resistant to some insect pest. Is always resistant to some insect pest. Okay, now. Dear students, previous classes we will discuss about what is the meaning of plant breeding, how many steps are involved in plant breeding process, how many breeding crops or hybrid varieties are identified in India. Next one, plant breeding are resistant to diseases. Plant breeding for developing resistant to insect pests. Insect pests. Okay, now today we are going to learn about plant breeding for improved food quality. Okay, now dear students, more than 840 million people in the world do not have adequate food to meet their daily food and nutrient requirements. A far begin rural number, 3 billion of people suffer from micronutrients, proteins, vitamin deficiency and iron hunger because they cannot be
afford to buy enough fruits, vegetables, legumes, fishes, and meat. Daily meeting to be lacking of essential micronutrients, particularly iron, zinc, copper, iodine, especially vitamin A. Vitamin A. Okay, now in those of time, so many scientists are invested or struggled to be identified one term, that is biofortifications. That is biofortifications. Several Indian breeding crops or hybrid crops are containing higher yield by means higher content of proteins, higher content of carbohydrates, higher content of vitamins, higher content of mineral nutrients, and high resistant to diseases, and abiotic tolerant to atmospheric stresses. Atmospheric stresses. These characters are having to several Indian hybrid crops or several Indian breeding crops. So these plant breeding crops are containing useful or economically healthful contents. These contents are together as named as biofortifications. Biofortifications. What is the meaning of biofortifications? Which means, as a plant breeding crops to having high quality of proteins, higher level of vitamins and minerals, and healthier fats. So to this, a most practical means by the public health, that is called biofortifications. Biofortifications can be produced several hybrid crop plants to be utilizing, undertaking to the objects, and also to be informing that. So those plant breeding crops are having protein contents, and also as well as maintained to be quantity, oil content, and also quality or quantity, mineral content and micronutrient content, and also vitamin content. So here we have observed some of the biofortifications food materials available in some of the hybrid crop plants, such as first one in the year 2000. Generally during the period 1960 to 2000, the increasing of the wheat production and rice production. Before the 2000, the wheat production 11 million tons. After 2000, the wheat production 75 million tons. As well as rice, before the 2000, so the rice is available in 35 million tons. After 2000, the rice available in 889.5 million tons. Why? Because this was the development of semi dwarf variety of wheat and rice. Semi dwarf variety of wheat and rice. This is the one important thing. Okay, now in the year 2000, the maize hybrids have containing so two basic sequence of the additional amount of five amino acids, that is lysine and tryptophan. Lysine and tryptophan. So by means lysine, tryptophan, both are amino acids. Both are amino acids. These amino acids are available in maize hybrids. Maize hybrids. Okay, now in the year 2000, the maize hybrids that had been twice amount of amino acids, with twice amount of amino acids, such as one amino acid is lysine, another amino acid is tryptophan. So two amino acids are available in maize hybrids. So that is maize hybrid is one of the biofortification of plant. Next one here, Atlas 66 variety of hybrid, that is wheat. Atlas 66 variety of hybrid, that is wheat, are having two high content of proteins. High content of proteins. At the same time, Atlas 66 to be used donor in the cultivation of wheat production. In the cultivation of wheat production. Next one here, as possible as on iron fortified rice variety, iron fortified rice variety are having to is much more than iron content, is much more than iron content. This iron content of rice is also commercially consumed variety. Commercially consumed variety. Next one here, golden rice. Next one here, golden rice. Golden rice are having containing beta carotene, as also containing vitamin A. Is also containing vitamin A. So already previous classes we will deeply discuss about golden rice. So the vitamin A is always prevent of blindness. Is always prevent of blindness. So these are the some biofortification of plants. These are the some biofortification of plants. These biofortification of plants, such as plant breeding crop plants, such as plant breeding crop plants. Okay, now dear students, next we are going to discuss about IARI, by means Indian Agricultural Research Institute. The Indian Agricultural Research Institute, located New Delhi. So to be introduced to several biofortified crop plants or several vegetable plants, several vegetable plants to be introduced. Okay, now the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, located New Delhi, that is IARI, to be introduced to several biofortified crop plants or several vegetable crop plants. So these vegetable crop plants are containing proteins, vitamins, and also as well as minerals, as well as minerals. So here discussion about some, so vegetable crop plants are some biofortified crop plants are some plant breeding crop plants. Plant breeding crop plants. Okay, now vitamin A enriched in carrot, spinach, and pumpkin. Okay, now so here carrot containing vitamin A, spinach containing vitamin A, pumpkin containing vitamin A. So here vitamin A enriched carrot, spinach, pumpkin. Next one here, vitamin C enriched in bitter gourd bathua, that is Chenopodium. Bathua means Chenopodium, king of the vegetables, king of the vegetables. Tomato and mustard.
by means bitter gourd containing vitamin C, batuka containing vitamin C, tomato containing vitamin C, mustard containing vitamin C. So here vitamin C enriched in bitter gourd, batuka, tomato and mustard. Next one here, iron and calcium. Iron and calcium enriched in spinach and batuka. Spinach and batuka. Okay, now spinach is also containing vitamin A as well as iron and calcium. Batuka is containing vitamin C as well as iron and calcium. So this is the importance of spinach and batuka. Both two are vegetable curry leaves. Both two are vegetable curry leaves. These two vegetable curry leaves are containing vitamin A, vitamin C as well as iron and calcium. Iron and calcium, that is the spinach and batuka. Next one here, proteins. So proteins are enriched in broad bean, lab bean, French bean and garden peas. So these are the important of some plant breeding crop plants or biofortified crop plants. Okay now, thank you. Dear students, today we are going to discuss about SCP. SCP means single cell protein or single cell proteins. Around 1960, between of the 2000 to be increasing of the several cropping plant food production, at the same time to be increasing of the population. So here to be increasing of the population as well as to be increasing of the agricultural food productions. Why? Because this was due to the development of several semi-dwarf varieties, such as semi-dwarf variety of rice, semi-dwarf variety of wheat and semi-dwarf variety of maize. These are the mainly three food grade crops, So as well as, population are increased at the same time, so they risk increasing of the diseases, reducing the population and affect mental abilities, More than 25% of human people is suffering from hidden hunger and mineral nutrients. In this time, to be alternate one source, so the alternate sources of proteins are available in algae, fungi, bacteria. So here, microbes are liking algae, fungi, bacteria are grown in large industrial scale, to be produced good proteins, that is called single cell protein, So here single cell proteins are available in some microbes, that is algae, fungi, bacteria, So here, dear students, algae, fungi, bacteria are used in single cell proteins, So both are unicellular organisms, that is unicellular organisms. Some of the algal members are in unicellular organisms, some of the fungal members are in unicellular organisms, some of the bacteria are in unicellular organisms. Most of the bacteria are here unicellular organisms. But here, these two are eukaryotic organisms, this one prokaryotic organisms. One prokaryotic organism and two eukaryotic organisms are produced in rich content of proteins, but both are single cells, both are unicellular organisms,
Unicellular organisms means the organism containing single cell. The organism containing single cell. So those both are unicellular organisms or single cell organisms to be containing rich content of proteins. To be containing rich content of proteins. More than 70% out of 100%, more than 70% are having to proteins. Are having to proteins. So here to be observed some single cell protein of organisms. Given the some examples of single cell proteins. Given the some examples of single cell proteins. First one here, some those of organ members, especially Spirulina maxima, Chlorella pyrenoidosa, and Celidesmus indicus. Celidesmus indicus. So these three are single cell or unicellular organism. Unicellular organisms. So these three are organ organisms. These three are organ organisms. By means Spirulina maxima containing proteins, Chlorella pyrenoidosa containing proteins, Celidesmus indicus containing proteins. Especially three organ members are containing rich content of proteins. So hence both are single cell proteins. Both are single cell proteins. Next discussion about fungi. So some of the fungal members are also to be containing rich content of proteins, such as Candida utilis. Such as Candida utilis. Candida utilis are commonly known as Torula yeast. Torula yeast. So generally organ members or fungal members are having to some of them unicellular and some of them multicellular. But especially only unicellular organisms are containing rich content of proteins and will be produced only proteins. Okay, now next Saccharomyces cerevisiae is one of the fungal member and also unicellular or commonly known as Baker's yeast. Okay, now Baker's yeast. And another one here, Chenopodium celluloricum. Chenopodium celluloricum. This is also one of the fungal organism and also unicellular organism. This organism containing protein content. This organism containing protein content. So here only three fungal members are having to rich content of proteins. Rich content of proteins. Next one here, for the examples of bacteria. So only two or three bacteria are having to rich content of proteins, such as Brevibacterium chitoglutamicum. Brevibacterium chitoglutamicum containing rich content of proteins. At the same time, Methylophilus methylotropus. Methylophilus methylotropus are containing rich content of proteins. Are containing rich content of proteins. Only few organ members, few fungal members, few bacterial members are having to rich content of proteins. These organ members, fungal members and bacterial members are grown in at a large scale of industries to be produced good proteins. To be produced good proteins, that is named single cell protein. That is named single cell protein. So one example are here to be preparation of single cell proteins. How to preparation of single cell proteins in the spirulina. So here spirulina is generally blue green algae and also single cell or unicellular organism. Okay, now so this spirulina is also to be prepared a one waste material. That is waste water and potato processing plants and available in sewage and molasses and as well as animal manure. Okay, now then after this spirulina to be produced high quantity of proteins, vitamins, fats, carbohydrates and minerals. This is a simple process of preparation of spirulina single proteins. Spirulina single proteins. Generally spirulina is one of the blue green algae and also unicellular organism So this spirulina organism especially grown in wastewater material and also to be grown up to potato processing plants and then after to be involved molasses and to be added animal manure and to be added sewage after some time this spirulina to be produced not only proteins and also to be produced high content of fats carbohydrates vitamins as well as minerals so here this spirulina is only produced high content of proteins and also to be useful in reduce of environmental pollution spirulina is also utilizing reduce of environmental pollution not only to be prepared of single cell proteins as also to be reduce of environmental pollution lichens is also reduce of environmental pollution and the spirulina is also reduce of environmental pollution and another fungal member that is mushroom spirulina is one of the blue green algae and also unicellular organism mushroom is one of the fungal member so so many foreign country peoples to be eating of the mushrooms so nowadays to be growing of the mushroom culture at the large scale so these mushrooms can having to proteins vitamins high content of vitamins and low content of carbohydrates and fats but high content of proteins vitamins and amino acids that is the importance of mushrooms okay now so in generally to be observed protein content so for example 250 kg cow so at the calculate okay here so at the calculate 250 kg of cow will be produced 200 gram of proteins per day but 250 grams of micro to be produced 20 tons of proteins okay students listen carefully 250 kg of cow will be produced 200 gram of proteins per day while 250 gram of micro that is Methylophilus methylotropus will be produced 20 tons of proteins per day okay clearly larger organism will be produced less quantity of proteins smaller organism will be produced higher quantity of proteins why because the smaller organism one of the microbe that is Methylophilus methylotropus are having to high biomass productivity and easily growth that is the difference of between cow and microbe okay here this is a very very simple logical thing so larger animal organism will be produced for a day 200 gram of proteins smaller microbial organism will be produced 20 tons proteins per day so these proteins are available in nowadays in human population so mainly available in protein contents vitamin contents and mineral nutrients so mainly these proteins are available in some algal organisms some fungal organisms some bacterial organisms anyhow some microbes like algae fungi bacteria are grown in industrial large scale of growth so to be source of good proteins so this phenomenon is known as single cell protein so single cell proteins are more available in spirulina and also mushrooms. Okay, now thank you.
Dear students, today we are going to discuss about tissue culture. What is the meaning of tissue culture? How many steps are involved in tissue culture? What are the advantages of tissue culture? So here the meaning of tissue culture.
Tissue culture is completely laboratory technique. The plants growing, culturing, and maintaining of the cells, tissues, and organs to be developed in vitro. That is called tissue culture. Okay, now generally cropping plants or hybrid cropping plants are grown for the soil, depend on the surrounding environment. But nowadays will be well developed biotechnology in this time. So to be well developed hybrid cropping plants and vegetable plants and also fruiting plants within a short period of the time to a limited space, in their grown in laboratory to be not utilized in the soil, only to be provided a soil of the mineral nutrients or mineral elements, as well as growth regulators, That is the meaning of plant tissue culture. Once again, plant tissue culture is completely laboratory technique. The plants which are grown, culturing, and maintaining of the cells, tissues, and organs in the vitro, that is called plant tissue culture. So this plant tissue cultures are involved in 6 steps. First step are here, preparation of nutrient culture medium. Second step are here, sterilization of culture medium. Third step are here, preparation of explant. Fourth step are here, inoculation of explant. Fifth step are here, incubation for growth. Sixth step are here, acclimatization of plantlets and transfer to pots. Okay, now it was earlier scientist during 1950s that whole plant can be regenerated from the explants. Explants means any part of the plant body taken out, and growing culture medium. And then after to be generated a new plant for any cell, that is called totipotency. By means tissue culture is always depend upon to the totipotency. Totipotency means plant of the any part is always generated. Part of the plant of the any part. Plant body of the any part will be again generated. That is called totipotency. So here tissue culture is always depend upon to the totipotency. Okay, now any part of the plant body taken out, that is called explant. This explant are grown in a test tube and added culture medium. Then after to be generated a new plant for any cell, that is called totipotency. So here tissue culture is always depend upon to the totally potency. Okay, now first step are here preparation of nutrient culture medium. Okay, now so in this laboratory technique, so first of all to be taken up to test tubes. So this test tubes to be filled with the nutrient culture medium. To be filled with the nutrient culture medium. This nutrient culture medium containing carbon sources of sucrose, inorganic salts, vitamins, amino acids, and growth regulators. Amino acids and growth regulators. This is the first step of preparation of nutrient culture medium. Okay, now preparation of nutrient culture medium. Tissue culture is totally one of the laboratory technique. In this laboratory to be taken up some amount of the test tubes. So in this test tube to be fulfilled with nutrient culture medium, to be fulfilled with nutrient culture medium. The nutrient culture medium containing carbon sources of sucrose, inorganic salts, okay now, vitamins, amino acids, and growth regulators. So here this nutrient culture medium is attracted by some of the microorganisms. So in this time, so this test tube of nutrient culture medium carried out by sterilization. That is sterilization of culture medium. Already one test tube containing sufficient nutrient culture medium. This culture medium is also containing sucrose, inorganic salts, vitamins, amino acids, and growth regulators. So some amount of sucrose is also containing and vitamins also containing. In this time some of the microorganisms to be attracted of the culture medium. So in this time to be test tube of culture medium carried out sterilization process. So here the culture medium carried out one sterilization process that is called autoclave. So in this autoclave, so to be killing of the microorganisms. In this autoclave to be killing of the microorganisms. So here culture medium of the autoclave to be evolved for 15 minutes time at 121 degree centigrade and 15 pounds of pressure to be applied. In this time, so several harmful microorganisms are to be killing. That is the steam sterilization. Okay, now nutrient culture medium is sterilized by steam sterilization. That is called autoclave. In this process, totally killing of the microorganisms or harmful pathogens. This is the second step for here sterilization of culture medium. So culture medium is always sterilized by autoclave. So in this autoclave to be killing of the some harmful microorganisms and some harmful pathogens. So being of the time 15 minutes, temperature 121 degree centigrade and pressure of the pounds 15 pounds of the pressure to be applied. In this time, so several harmful pathogens and microorganisms to be killing. Next one here, preparation of explant. So any part of the plant body taken out, that is called explant. To be taken, plant body of the root, plant body of the stem, plant body of the leaf, plant body of the flower. To be taken any part of the plant body
that is called explant. Okay, that is called explant. This is explant. So this is a nutrient culture medium of test tube. This is explant of test tube. This is explant of test tube. So first step are here preparation of nutrient culture medium. So this is a nutrient culture medium of test tube. Second step are here sterilization of culture medium. Third step are here preparation of explant. This is a explant of test tube. This is a explant of test tube. Next one is here. So inoculation of explant. So this explant to be transferred. This explant to be transferred. This explant to be transferred in the test tube. This explant to be transferred in the test tube. That is called inoculation. That is called inoculation. This explant to be transferred in the test tube. That is called inoculation. To be provided a aseptic environment. To be provided a aseptic environment. That is called inoculation of explant. Okay, now three steps are here. First one here preparation of nutrient culture medium. Second step are here sterilization of culture medium. Third step are here preparation of explant. Fourth step are here inoculation of explant. This is a first step diagram. This is a third and fourth step diagram. Third and fourth step diagram. Okay, now so first step are here preparation of nutrient culture medium, and then after to be fulfilled with culture medium in the test tube. Next one here to be transferred to explant. To be transferred to explant in the test tube. In the test tube. Dear students, previous classes we will discuss about four steps in tissue culture. Four steps in tissue culture. Four steps are completed. That is preparation of nutrient culture medium, sterilization of culture medium, preparation of explant, inoculation of explant. So today we are going to discuss about fifth step in plant tissue culture. That is incubation for growth. That is incubation for growth. Already the test tube containing nutrient culture medium, another test tube containing nutrient culture medium and also explant. And also explant. So to be observed, third test tube are here. That is the fifth step, incubation for growth. Incubation for growth. Already part of the any plant body taken out. So that would be taken out to leaf. That is a explant. So this explant of leaf or any plant cell incubated for growth in 3 to 4 months. 3 to 4 months. Okay, now already transfer of explant or any plant cell in the nutrient culture medium of the test tube. So this test tube of explant or any plant cell to be incubated for their growth, that is 3 to 4 months. That is 3 to 4 months are incubated. 3 to 4 months. Okay, now the explant or any plant cell to be incubated for the growth period 3 to 4 months. Okay, now so in this period the explant to be absorbed culture medium of mineral nutrients and then grow and repeated cell divisions, repeated cell divisions to be formed a procreated undifferentiated mass of cells, that is called callus. That is called callus. 3 to 4 months the explant will be changed of the callus. The explant will be changed of the callus being of the period 3 to 4 months. In 3 to 4 months the explant to be absorbed culture medium of the nutrients or nutrient culture medium and also the explant grow
and repeated cell divisions, and to be formed a forformate undifferentiated mass of the cells. So these undifferentiated mass of the cells is known as callus. So callus is formed. So in this callus is directly to be produced shoot and root. Sometimes in this callus is directly produced shoot and roots. Sometimes, so this callus first will be absorbed into growth regulators of auxins, then will be absorbed into growth regulators of cytokines to be make a one new plantlet. That is called organogenesis. Okay, now the explant in the 3 to 4 months of period to be absorbed test tube of nutrient culture medium and then grow and again repeated cell divisions to be form undifferentiated mass of cells that is known as callus. In this callus sometimes to be directly developed to root system and shoot system. But generally, so the callus to be absorbed nutrient culture medium of one growth regulator that is auxin. First to be absorbed auxin, so to be form of roots. And then after to be absorbed to nutrient culture medium of another growth regulator that is cytokinin to be form of shoot. So both root system and shoot system are forming in their callus. To be making a new plantlet. That is called organogenesis. By means the nutrient culture medium of test tube containing one new plant. Callus is formed one new plantlet. But here sometimes this callus is directly developed embryo-like structures. That is called somatic embryogenesis. The test tube of callus to be developed directly embryo-like structures. That is called somatic embryogenesis. Or so the embryos are developed in their callus of test tube. That is called embryos. These embryos are developed callus. That is called somatic embryos. Both are the similar words are here. Okay, now callus means undifferentiated mass of cells is known as callus. Then after callus is formed a organogenesis. Organogenesis means callus is formed a plant body of root system and shoot system. By means plant body organs are developed. In their callus. Mainly plant body organ that is root. Second one is a shoot. First plant body organ here root. Second plant body organ here shoot. These are the main plant body organs: root system, shoot system, and also leaves. So here some of the growth regulators to be involved to be developing a new plantlet. So next one here, somatic embryogenesis. Sometimes this callus is directly developed to embryo-like structures. That is called somatic embryogenesis. And embryo-like structures are developed to be their callus. That is called embryos. Embryos are developed directly in the the calls.
That is called somatic embryo, somatic embryos. That is called somatic embryos. That is called somatic embryos. This is the fifth step in incubation for growth. Incubation for growth. Okay, now sixth step are here. Acclimatization of plantlets and transfer to pars.
So here several economically useful cropping plants would be developed in the laboratory techniques. So these plants generated through organogenesis or somatic embryo genesis need to be acclimatized, that is surrounding atmosphere, need to be acclimatized before the transfer to pars. That is the acclimatization of plantlets and transfer to pars. So these are the six steps in plant tissue culture. Okay, now what are the advantages of plant tissue culture? So generally, so these plants are possible produce a large number of plants being a short period of the time in a limited space, So these plants are known as micropropagation. This is our advantage. Okay, now several tissue cultures plants are developed. So in this tissue culture plants are produced large number of the plants being a limited period of the time or short period of the time and is a limited space this process is known as micropropagation. These plants totally produce genetically identical same by means same of the original plant or same of the source. That is called soma clones. This is the one of the advantages. Okay, now micropropagation plants will be developed and soma clones plants will be developed. Micropropagation means several plants will be produced by means large number of plants, short period of the time and limited space. So this process is known as micropropagation. So in this process several economically important plants will be produced. So these plants will be genetically identical to be similar of original plant or source. That is called soma clones. Okay, here so several micropropagation will be plants are developed. So that is hay, eucalyptus, banana, bamboo and also potato. These plants will be developed in their micropropagation process. At the same time, female plants will be well developed in their tissue culture technique. And the next advantage are here. So, somatic embryos will be developed in their tissue culture process. By means somatic embryos easily multiplied. So these plants easily grown for the tissue culture process. And at the same time, so many somatic plants will be developed, mainly in belong to the plant cell of protoplast. So two different plant cells of protoplast are fused to be developed one hybrid variety of plants. That is called somatic hybridization. That is called somatic hybridization. Given the example are here, one potato plant of the protoplast is crossed with another tomato plant of protoplast to be making a one new variety of somatic hybrid plant. That is pomato. That is pomato. Okay, now tomato crossed with potato to be making a new plant. That is called pomato. That is called pomato. The best example are here somatic hybridization. The best example here somatic hybridization. By which there is no involving of asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. Only involved the plant cell of the protoplast. Two different plant species are here. One different plant species, tomato. Another different plant species are here, potato. So tomato protoplast are filled with the potato protoplast to be making a produce a new hybrid variety plant. That is called pomato. This is a somatic hybridization. So these are the advantages of plant tissue culture. Okay, now so this is a first diagram, that is preparation of nutrient culture medium. This is a second diagram, that is a preparation of explant and inoculation of explant. So these are incubation of explants. These are incubation for growth. Okay, now this is a plant tissue culture steps. Okay, now dear students, today we are going to discuss about flow chart showing plant tissue culture. This is a flow chart in plant tissue culture. Already previous classes will be discussed about what is the meaning of plant tissue culture, how many steps are involved in plant tissue culture, what are the advantages of plant tissue culture. Today we are going to briefly discuss about flow chart in plant tissue culture. Okay, now flow chart in plant tissue culture. So here first here preparation of medium. Then medium taken in test tubes. In their test tubes sterilized in autoclave. Next one here to be taken plant body. So the plant body of any part to be taken out. That is called explant. Any part of the plant body, that is root, either stem, either leaf, either flower, either tissues. So here any part of the plant body to be taken out, that is called explant. Next one here, this explant to be transferred in the test tubes. That is inoculation. So meaning under sterile condition. Why? Because test tubes is always sterilized. By means test tube fulfilled with nutrient culture medium. This nutrient culture medium to be attracted by some harmful microorganisms, especially fungal organisms and bacterial organisms. So this fungal organisms, totally to be destroyed of the nutrient culture medium. In this time is always to be sterilized the test tubes. Okay, now so next one here. So explant is always transferred into the test tube. That is explant inoculation. once. Okay, now by means explant is incubation. The incubation of explant for their period 3 to 4 months. In this period, the incubation of explant to be observed. Test tube of nutrient culture mediums, test tube of nutrient culture medium, and easily grow. Then after to be repeated cell divisions and to be form a one perforation of undifferentiated mass of the cells. So these undifferentiated mass of the cells is known as callus. That is callus formation. That is callus formation. By means in their laboratory technique of these test tubes are forming of the callus. Are forming of the callus by means the nutrient culture medium to be making a callus. To be making a callus from the explant. From the explant. Okay, here. So callus formation, that is transfer to medium. That is transfer to medium. So sometimes explant is directly to be making a new plant. Sometimes the inoculation of explant is directly to be produced one new plant or one new plantlet. One new plantlet, that is daughter plant. That is daughter plant. Okay, now. So the inoculation of explant sometimes the inoculation of explant is directly to be produced one new plantlet or one new daughter plant. This is one process. Next one here. So already the test tube to be make a, the test tube of explant to be make a callus. So this callus first to be observed. This callus first to be observed. The growth of all this, next observe the growth hormones of cytokines to be making a plant body of organs such as root system and such as shoot system. So this process is known as organogenesis. This process is known as organogenesis. That is root and shoot formation. That is root and shoot formation. The root shoot formation, that is one new plantlet. That is one new plantlet. Okay, here callus formation. So this callus formation is directly to be form of a organogenesis. Callus formation generally to be produce a organogenesis. This organogenesis finally to be produce a well developed one plantlet. Another are here. This callus formation by means this callus is directly to be form a embryo like structures. This callus directly to be produce a embryo like structures. That is called somatic embryos. That is called somatic embryos. Okay, now. So generally, sometimes the inoculation of explant is directed to be produced one new plant or one new daughter plant, or the inoculation of explant to be make a callus. This callus to be make a organogenesis. This organogenesis to be make a one new plantlet. But sometimes, so this callus is directly to be produced embryo-like structures. This callus is directly to be produced embryo-like structures. Embryo-like structures. So that is called somatic embryogenesis. That is called somatic embryogenesis. So these somatic embryos, so to be making a artificial seeds. To be making a artificial seeds. These artificial seeds without not covering up the seed cores. Without not covering up the seed cores. Generally, the normal foods enclose the seeds. Seeds containing seed coat, that is a protect layer. But the callus to be produce a embryo-like structures, that is called somatic embryos. Somatic embryos. By means somatic means there is no involvement of asexual. There is no involvement of sexual. Only the protoplasm or cytoplasm to be fusing. Only the protoplasm or cytoplasm to be fusing within the form of embryos. Within the form of embryos. So here the callus to be produced a embryo-like be making artificial seeds are again this homotic embryos again transferred to culture medium. This is again transferred to culture medium and this homotic embryos directly to be produced new plantlets. Directly produce new plantlets or the somatic embryos to be make a artificial seeds. To be make a artificial seeds. These artificial seeds are to be germinating after some time to be developed to new plantlets. To be developed to new plantlets. New plantlets of new daughter plants. This is a flowcharting plant tissue culture. This is a flowcharting plant tissue culture. So anyhow, inoculation of explant will be directly developed plantlets. The test tube of callus will be developed to be new plantlets. Will be developed to be new plantlets. Okay, now thank you.